It's Fran, again in the lab at the bench with the third in my problem series. This one is a problem that happened to me recently, and it has definitely happened to you. You have an electronic device that's battery operated, and one day it just stops working, so you just decide to change out the batteries. You open up the battery compartment and you find, oh no, the humanity. Why, you ask, why does this happen? What is it about alkaline batteries that they explode and destroy the device that they're supposed to be powering, you know? What is this white stuff? Why does it happen? Well, it's chemically pretty simple, actually, because the alkaline batteries, they're powered by an electrolyte. Usually it's potassium hydroxide. And as the battery loses its power and begins to age, the electrolyte begins to break down and it begins to release H2, hydrogen gas. And so over time, if the battery gets to the point of even like being dead or low power condition inside of the device for a long enough period of time, depending on the design of the battery, well, that hydrogen gas builds up and eventually it just kind of breaks out of the container, and coming out of the breach along with the hydrogen gas is the potassium hydroxide, which then just kind of just reacts with whatever it comes in contact with, which is usually the contacts in the battery compartment. But you usually don't find the liquid electrolyte in around the batteries. Usually you find this white salt material, and that's because the potassium hydroxide reacts with carbon dioxide in the air and becomes potassium carbonate. And from what I read, potassium carbonate is actually a very chemically stable compound. It's basically like as like stable as table salt, but you don't want to handle it. You don't want to get it on your hands. You definitely don't want to inhale it. So you gotta be careful working with corroded batteries, even if you want to clean out the battery compartment. If the leak happened recently and you're wearing, you know, you wear gloves and take the batteries out carefully, don't, you know, get the stuff on you, you can clean up the rest of the potassium carbonate with just using a diluted acid solution, like either diluted white vinegar or just lemon juice, something like that, on Q-tip, and, you know, very slowly dissolve it and, you know, wash it away with some distilled water, whatever. But you know, if you can take the device apart to actually separate the battery compartment so you're not getting like acids and stuff into the other works. But often what happens is by the time you find that the battery has exploded, too much time has passed, and generally, at least in my experience, the battery compartment contacts are usually corroded and usually irretrievable. And if they're molded into the device and it's not something you can just swap out, then usually the device is just, you got to toss it out and everything. But, you know, so it begs the question, why can't they make an alkaline battery that won't leak? Well, the answer is that they kind of do. In fact, if you kind of get into the research and looking for leak-proof alkalines, there are lots of choices of, like, brands of, like, guaranteed leak-proof alkaline batteries that you can buy online. I've never used any of these, but, you know, they're there. But, you know, usually, I think most people tend not to buy batteries, you know, in, like, it's in like a 100-piece bulk or like a big, you know, bulk container from eBay. They would, you know, get it at the supermarket or at the hardware store when you get the rack of batteries. You know, you need a battery, you grab it. So I did a little kind of poking around, and I found that, you know, in the, you know, supermarket brand batteries, there are a couple of like sure bets. One is the Energizer, which they have a leak-proof guarantee. Although, kind of read the fine print, it'll say, you know, they're guaranteed to be leak-proof up to 2 years after fully dead. That's not forever, but I have to say, I've had Energizers, dead Energizers, that I've had in devices that have been like four years past and no leakage whatsoever. So if they're generally a good, like, you know, dependable supermarket brand. Although the shelf life does vary a lot. They're round cells, like they're AA's, AAA's, C's, D's. They guarantee for up to 10 years storage, but their 9 volts are only guaranteed for 5, the standard 9 volts. You find this a lot with 9-volt batteries, and that's why, like, for a long, long time, I was buying ProCells. But the one thing I'm not ever going to do again is buy Duracell, because the copper top Duracells, they're notorious, notorious for leaking. And I put up a post on my blog about this, and so many people were talking about Duracells, you know, how, you know, like, decades ago, Duracell was, like, the battery to buy, but, you know, recently, You just wouldn't want to put a copper top Duracell in anything that you just didn't want to destroy. Although, ironically, like for decades, I was buying the Duracell Pro Cells, the 9 volts, with much success. I never had any of the Pro Cells leak, and they had a very high, long shelf life. So, yeah, I guess it's, you know, you really kind of have to do a lot of research and trial and error to find batteries that will be leak-proof and also will, you know, serve you a long time. So we got it. Here we have an assortment of batteries. A lot of these I've pulled. Some of them are a little leaky. I'm going to use a pair of gloves. Whenever you buy, like, an appliance, you'll get some batteries with it, like something like this, like King Kong brand. Have you ever heard of King Kong? King Kong brand AAAs. Yeah, very dependable King Kong brand. Your Shinon AAAs, or Sunbeam 9 volt. Sunbeam, aren't they a bread company? They're a bread company, aren't they? Sunbeam, super heavy duty. Doesn't feel very super heavy duty, just based on weight. That's for sure. Like this one here, 777 battery. It says made in PRC, not China, People's Republic of China. I don't know how old this battery is. No, it says 2009. But man, is that like vintage packaging or something? It's got a barcode on it. PRC, wow, People's Republic of China. So I guess they haven't changed this, you know, packaging for 20, 30 years, 40 years, something like that. The Mitsubishi Alkaline. Well, you'd think, you know, Mitsubishi, very reliable, you know, electronics company. Are their batteries any good? I don't know. I mean, who makes the Mitsubishi electric battery? Do they actually make their own batteries, or is this just a tags, you know, put on a regular just Chinese battery? Who knows? And this one, the GI, super heavy duty battery. I think this is actually not an alkaline. I think this is an acid battery, I think. It doesn't say alkaline, so this probably is not an alkaline battery. It's probably one of those, you know, acid batteries that people like to do. Sometimes people like to go vintage with their batteries, although I don't subscribe to the idea that vintage electronics should have, you know, acid batteries in them. There's a heated debate about that, and I'm sure there'll be arguments in the comments, but I don't subscribe to the idea. I use alkaline batteries in all my old transistor radios and stuff, and without any incident. So, or how about Utiltech AAAs? It's all these weird off-brand AAAs. You get all these with devices, and, you know, generally you just end up sticking them in until they, you know, go. So in the regular, like, supermarket batteries, I prefer Energizer, although the Rayovac, which I also sometimes get, they also have a leak-proof guarantee, although it is in very fine print, leak-proof guarantee. And, you know, they have the same kind of 10-year guarantee as the Energizers. And you can kind of test to that because, like, for instance, this lantern battery, this is a Rayovac. And they, you know, I really wish that they made these really extra long-lasting pile lantern batteries. I don't know if they even make them anymore. I've actually opened this one up because I wanted to see the cells that were inside. And this one actually, it actually is a genuine pile battery. But oftentimes, if you get a lantern battery like this, a 6-volt lantern battery, and you were to crack it open, sometimes they're just full of generic, unbranded AA batteries that they just got stacked up in there. But a real pile battery like this is heavy. This is a really heavy battery. It's just, and this is actually still good. I got this, It's good till February 2011, but I've been using this battery since, I don't know, whenever I did my Arduino Firefly jar project. But I've been using this battery actually to power my Firefly jar with an adapter. I put a little plug on the top, and it's been powering my bedside Firefly jar for all these years. I don't know how many years it's been, eight, nine years. And it's actually still got charge. But the ones that I get now, like if I go to the hardware store and they've got lantern batteries, they weigh about like a third of what this one weighs. Yeah, I just put this on the scale. This is 1 kilo, a kilogram, over 2 pounds. You're not going to find too many of these lantern batteries that actually have like that much battery in them anymore. But I used to love using lantern batteries for projects and stuff, because you know you can regulate them down and everything. It's just a very solid, you know, power source. You can, you know, portable power source. But yeah, it's just, you know, a lot of people recommend lithium batteries. In the forum, people are saying, well, just go with lithium batteries. You know, you'll never have a problem with leaking. But actually, it's not 100%, because the, you know, lithium batteries can leak, especially lithium coin cell batteries. I used to have two of these, this distance measuring tool. It's a very handy device. It's got a little wheel, you know, and a little optical encoder, and you can start and stop and use this for drafting and such, or doing woodwork or whatever. You can run it over a very complex shape or complex curves, and it'll translate the exact distance of that line going around. You know, you can do right angles and, you know, everything. Very handy tool. Used to have two of them, but they run on lithium coin cells, and when I went through the lab this few weeks ago, you know, finding everything that had batteries in it and checking them, the other one of these, the cells were still in there and they were lithiums, and the inner cell had leaked out, leaked into the electronics, and the whole thing was destroyed. So it's just had to throw it out. But the longevity of lithium cells, it varies wildly. Like these energizers, for example, these are 2016s, which is very common for, like, you know, car key fobs and, you know, calculators, things like that. These are actually guaranteed through 2030, but other coin cells, like for thermometers and stuff like that, those smaller cells, they're usually only guaranteed for, like, you know, 3-4 years, which, you know, makes it really difficult, because, like, something like a thermometer, a digital thermometer, you might use maybe once every, I mean, if you don't get sick all the time, you might use one like every 4 or 5 years. And if the batteries that actually go in them only really last for like 2, 3, 4 years at best, the next time you turn on your thermometer and the batteries are dead, you open up the back and it's just going to be a big ugly mess. So I've actually, like I said, I went through the whole lab to find everything that had a battery in it, and change out old batteries. Things that I, you know, I have a lot of battery operated things that I use occasionally. And so the occasional ones I put Energizer Maxes in, because again, up to 10 years for the, you know, for the cylindrical batteries, you're not gonna have a leaking problem if it's not just sitting there on the shelf and everything. But I have taken to labeling the devices that I don't use that frequently, and putting on there the expiration of the battery, so that I know next time I use it, if I use it like once a year or something, that when it comes around, you know, that I'll know, oh, this is the year that I got to change the battery out. And I've, you know, done this just to sort of to prevent having to throw out more devices as the years go on. But I have to say, the topper for this video is the longest lasting set of batteries that I currently have. And it's these. There are three of them. These are GP green cells. Extra heavy duty. Okay, so these expired in 2002, July 2002. But these three GP green cells came installed in this 30th anniversary Kermit the Frog talking doll that I got as a Christmas present from, I guess, my parents in 1999. This doll was in storage. I'd forgotten all about it. It's got this switch where you can squeeze its tummy, and it opens its mouth, and it activates a switch, which clicks on the talking module. He says, hi-ho, Kermit the Frog here, which I'm not going to do because it's probably copyrighted and probably get slammed. But I had this, like I said, this was in storage forever, and I had it sitting up on my shelf, and just, you know, I was remembering, well, how does this thing, and I remember, oh, you can push its stomach, and I pushed its stomach, and it very loudly said, hi-ho, Kermit the Frog here, and I was like, what the F? And opened it up, and it still had the original batteries in it, and not only that, but the batteries are still good. 1.48 volts. Still at 1.48 volts. So the GP green cells, they win hands down. And I have to remember that that voice-activated doll, that is always on. It's an always-on circuit. So for that to be on for 21 years on standby, I know it's, you know, it's probably got like a MOSFET-activated switch or whatever, but there's always power to those switches because it's just a you know, one-touch, you know, push-button switch, and it activates the chip, you know, to say the words. So, you know, 21 years active on, and they're still good. They never leaked, down a little bit in voltage, but still got plenty of current because they were able to drive the speaker and everything just as loud as new. So that blew my mind. 21 years. That wins the prize. All right, well, that's it for this one. Thanks for watching. Thanks too to all of the patrons down there on that Patreon, making all these videos possible, including this one. Thank you, thank you, thank you, everyone who supports me on Patreon, because it's the only reason that I'm doing this. It's the only way that I can do this. Patrons, they rock. Keep the lights on, keep me going. Yep. Back in Fran Lab time. So this was it, problem number 3. I hope that you got some good advice out of this, and I think, you know, actually device labeling, it turned out to be kind of like a smart thing to do with items that you don't use all the time. Like if you're using like your TV remote, when it starts like not working so well, you're gonna be able to change out the batteries long before they go kerplooey, especially if they're a no leak guarantee brand. But stuff that you're gonna have like just occasionally, like a laser level or like some, you know, kind of like specialty device that takes batteries. I know even like calipers and stuff have little coin cells in them now because they're all digital, and stuff like that drives me absolutely bonkers because, you know, how do you keep track of all these batteries? So I've been pretty much getting used to taking batteries out of a lot of these things and like storing them with them in a plastic bag or something. Until I'm going to use it again, but it's just, it is a maddening, frustrating thing. And of course, the widely varying degrees of lifespan of batteries, especially coin cells, very frustrating. So, anyway, that's it. I'm Fran. I'll be back here real soon. Bye! Berserk in my lab, it's where I work. That's a good one.